Your kid needs to climb trees, to fall off here and there, and you probably are there to hold it up and to minimize the risks. But it has to take risks, and it has to sing songs and play with others, and do all kinds of things, roam around. It's important.
It should be perfectly clear that the smartphone and the tablet is not to be used as a pacifier, because if it is used as a pacifier, it has the same side effects as alcohol and opioids.
So how do we get it self-control? Well, actually in kindergarten. What do you do to reach self-control? You sing a song. Because singing a song is fun. That's how you learn self-control. The tobacco lobby is this big compared to the digital lobby. It's this big. You have to realize this.
W dzisiejszym odcinku naszym gościem jest profesor Manfred Spitzer, neurobiolog, psychiatra i pisarz. Jak wspierać młodych ludzi, aby pomóc im jak najlepiej wejść w dorosłość?
Well, I think first of all, kids pretty much know what they do, and they, if they're just surrounded by, well, other people, by as much as different aspects of the real world, then they will pick up things, they will interact with the real world, and due to this interaction, which is a highly active thing for kids, they will get to know the world, they will get to know the language, their mother tongue, etc., etc. So if we just let them develop properly and help them here and there and interact with them, we do everything right. Okay, no special things needed. And that also means, don't replace the real world with some screens and hope for the best. That's not a good idea, because the virtual reality is not the real reality, and it lacks quite a few things. And let me give you an example. It comes from Science Magazine, was published in 2015. And what they did, they had 11-month-old babies sitting on the lap of mothers, and they looked at this. And there was a little theater, puppet theater, okay? And a hand came down and put a car on a ramp. So the car rolled down and then disappeared behind a screen. And the baby heard, dop. And then the screen was taken up, and the car was either there, he was a block here at was hit, had hit the block and it was here, or it was here at another block. So the car in the second case must have gone through the block, the other one here, okay? Or there was a stone, and the car was pushed and then off the stone, or there was a stone with a little glass, and then the car was pushed, and the car seemed to fly in midair. Okay, what happened? The children looked longer if something happened that they didn't expect. That is, the car is in midair, or the car ran through a block. That was interesting, but the real interesting part came when the children who just had watched something that is not really happening, okay, were given the little car. Because in the cases where they saw the car appears to fly, they took the car and let it fall down. And in the case where they saw the car going apparently through a block, they took the car and banged it on the table to find out, does this really go through something strong and wooden, okay? So even 11, and that was the point of the whole study was, well, 25 years ago, psychologists published The Scientist in the Crib, a book about two-year-olds who constantly fool around, or appear to fool around, but they don't. They just interact with the world. They try things out, and they're making constant experiments with the world in order to come to grips with it, to understand what's going on. And now it turns out it's not two-year-olds, it's 11-month-olds who already do this. Okay, but in order to do it, you need the real world. A screen doesn't help you making experiments with the real world. And this is what children constantly do. Okay, so I think good parents observe this all the time, okay, and let kids do it. But nowadays, we have to quote scientific papers in order to show, hey, this is really how it works. And if you give this kid a tablet, it doesn't work. So you are actually impairing the kids' chances to get to know the world. And this is now, it's an important message, because we surround our kids from birth on, basically, with digital information technology, which actually hurts them and doesn't help them.
Jak nauczyć uczniów, ich rodziców i nauczycieli mądrego korzystania z technologii cyfrowych?
That's the wrong question. Okay. With kids, there's no wise use, because it hurts so much and it does so much damage to the eyesight, to their movement capacity, to their actually knowledge creation. There's no right way for a two-year-old to interact with digital technology. It's just wrong to have him interact. The problem is this. 100 years ago, when a kid was, you know, uneasy and loud, etc., we had a little cloth. We soaked it in alcohol and opioids, poppy seeds, and then we put this under the tongue of the kid. And it became calm and maybe slept a little, okay. So this was the pacifier, okay? And when we used this stuff, and today people say, what? They did what? Alcohol, opioids? Hey, we know that this impairs with brain development and it causes addiction. What do parents do these days? They pull out their tablet or their smartphone. And the uneasy child will go easy. And the reason is, the stuff is addictive and the stuff is impairing brain development. So, and it, by doing this, and by comparing this to this 100-year-old pacifier, I think it should be perfectly clear that the smartphone and the tablet is not to be used as a pacifier. Because if it is used as a pacifier, it has the same side effects as alcohol and opioids. It impairs brain development and it causes addiction. That's important to realize, and parents just don't notice this. But we do know that this is the case, which is why I'm so strict about this. Parents should know and never use digital technology as pacifiers.
Smartphone. Dlaczego wywołuje tak silne emocje?
I think the discussion about smartphones creates so much emotionality because it's so simple to give them out and to have a good time while the kids are seeming to have a good time too. And so if I say to parents, you must not do this, I say, oh, but I want some free time and I want to be let alone for a few minutes, so I give this out. And the kid interacting with the tablet is not going to be overrun by a truck, because it's not falling off trees, it's not roaming around in the wild, it can't be kidnapped. So it's right in the living room and it's quiet, and so it's a safe way to deal with the problem of a cranky kid and you have no time for it. And this is why people get emotional, because it's so easy to use smartphones as pacifiers that people just don't want this capacity not to use this capacity, so to speak. And which is why only education helps. If you know how bad it really is, you wouldn't do it. I mean, parents normally don't want to harm their kids. That's probably a normal thing for a parent, not to want to harm the kid. They just don't know that they harm the kid. And we don't have many, many papers in the media saying, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this, because we have a big lobby. And the big lobby is like the tobacco lobby. Tobacco is great, tobacco is freedom, tobacco is hip, and tobacco is young and sportive and sexy and everything, okay? And because we have this lobby saying digital is the future, digital is great, and digital you must not be left behind. So if you give your kid, a two-year-old, the smartphone, he'll become a programmer and a big cheese in artificial intelligence. If people know that the opposite is the case, that they really harm their kid by doing so, then they can make their own decisions, their informed decisions and the responsible decisions. And I think the problem is the big lobby that's telling us constantly the wrong things, just like in smoking. And we have to stand against this lobby. And in fact, the tobacco lobby is this big compared to the digital lobby. It's this big. We have to realize this. The tobacco lobby in Germany alone caused about 140,000 dead people per year for about 50 years. And after 50 years, politicians thought, oh, well, it's not so good idea, so we reduce advertisement. By now in Germany, you can't smoke in public buildings, etc., etc. And actually, lung cancer is on the decline. We used to have 440,000, but by now we have about 120,000. But it takes decades for the effect to take place. Same thing with digital media. If we stop them now, we are still going to have a huge amount of side effects in 30 or 40 years from now. Dementia, blindness, stroke, heart attacks. That's only a few of the bigger things that are going to happen, given what we do now. So we are going to have a huge wave of that. And if we act now, the wave is going to go down in maybe 45 years. And if we don't act, it's going to be up and up and up.
W jaki sposób można wzmocnić odporność psychiczną dziecka?
Well, I think helping kids develop is the same thing as helping them develop resistance to crises. And helping them develop proper language is one thing. Because if they know the language and they can express themselves, they can talk about what their problems are. If they can't even talk, then they can't even get some help, okay? This is one thing. The other thing is that we know a lot about what's called executive functioning, that is self-control. And the self-control goes along with emotional control, and this is basically being in control of what you're doing, what you're thinking, and what your emotional life is going to be. So if you don't develop self-control, you are constantly bombarded by your emotions, you are thrown around by your emotions, you do this and that, and you don't think about what you do, and you do not so good things oftentimes, okay? If you develop self-control, you are a fully functioning person in the end, and you are kind of well-behaved. And I don't mean just a good person, but you do good to yourself, basically. You brush your teeth, which is, and so in the long run, you have better teeth. And you don't indulge in sweets, so in the long run, you don't suffer from diabetes, etc., etc. Which is why actually self-control is known to make you live longer, to make you happier, and to make you a richer person because you're more productive. So how do we get at self-control? Well, actually in kindergarten. What do you do to reach self-control? You sing a song. Because singing a song is fun. That's how you learn self-control. You do funny things that only work if you finish them. I mean, nobody sings a half of a song, okay, and then stops, because it's not fun to do so. Or you play a game. You don't stop a game halfway. You play it to the end, okay? Or you play theater. And if adolescents play Shakespeare, they know how jealousy, how rage, how envy, how suffering, how being in love and not loved back, how that feels, because they have acted this out using, well, Shakespeare in theory. Shakespeare is great because he has all that and more, okay? So if you acted this out, you know how to act when you live it through yourself, and you don't throw an SMS out, I don't want to live any longer, because that's what kids do these days, and then the police is called, and then they bring them to the psychiatric acute ward for acute suicidal behavior, okay? Once, if they had acted Shakespeare, they would just talk to a friend and say, I go through this and this, and the friend would say something, and they would go about this in a normal way, okay? So it is. Sports, same thing. I mean, in sports, everybody has to stick to the rules. Otherwise, a rule-based game doesn't make any sense. So you learn to stick to rules. And so self-control is not something difficult, or it's a very simple thing. And we have many things in kindergartens that basically are self-control training regimes. They are not sold as such, but they are, okay? Which is why we have the kindergartens that we have, because they have good results. They produce citizens that you can work with and that live through their lives and that are happy, okay? And so again, let me add, this must not be replaced by digital media. Oh, let's replace theater with a little TV. Let's replace singing a song with a, well, singing along with a CD or something. No, do the real thing and do it in a community, and then you will get self-control. And these days, you have to make sure not to interfere with what's good for the kids and what has been done for centuries to bring up kids.
Jakie pan ma przesłanie do rodziców i nauczycieli?
Let's face it, you want the best for your child, don't you? So the question is, what is the best? And the best is all kinds of things, different things, roaming around, do sports, theater, music, playing with other kids. That's probably the most important thing. And let the kid do that and protect it, sure, against things that are not so good. And you must know that there are companies out there that try to monetize the time of your kid. That's actually their mission. They're called Apple, Google, Amazon, Facebook, Microsoft. And you have to have the courage to say, no, I don't want that. I don't want these companies to get rich by risking the health and the education of my kid. My kid needs me to protect it from, well, these influences, and to give it what it really needs, that is nature, exploration, motivation, and fun with other kids. And if you do this, you'll have a great kid.
Zbieraj z nami młode pokolenie. Wybierz skuteczny program profilaktyczny dla twojej szkoły.